Ladies and gentlemen, side opposition is all for ending poverty.
But that does not mean we stand for ending poverty by any means necessary. Today, we stand to avoid an ineffective and societally damaging policy. But we also stand to avoid burdening the individual with an illegitimate and harmful policy, which will only serve to undermine the people that they are trying and should be trying to value in society. As the first speaker from opposition, I'm going to be doing three things. Firstly, showing you that there are massive harms to the individual that are just too great to accept. Secondly, showing you that the burden placed by this community service is illegitimate because these people do not owe their society anything. And thirdly, showing you that even if we assume we could burden them, the policy provided by side proposition will not actually end the suffering which they tried to end in today's debate. My second speaker, Amelia, will then be showing you that on top of this lack of effectiveness and lack of fairness, the aptly named Team Black Swan's policy will only be a black swan for society, an unexpected and unmitigated disaster. So, moving straight on to my substantive matter, which is going to directly rebut side proposition's case. And the first thing to establish is the harm to the individual. Because in a debate about forcing people to work for 1 year of their life, they did not a single cent of analysis to justify why it wouldn't damage them or why it would give them any benefit in terms of experience, missing out a probably pretty valuable opportunity as side proposition. So why does this harm individuals? Let's just establish this quickly. Firstly, we'd say they're giving up a year of their life. Now we'd say in that time, A, they're not earning, and we'd say that this is pretty bad for anyone, but specifically, if you're the 60% of people in South African universities who are poor and who can't afford to go to those universities, you're probably feeding your family. That means for a year, you aren't able to work and provide for the people you are supposed to be supporting. Secondly, you're unhappy, because A, we think the job itself makes you unhappy, because you might not like community service because you haven't volunteered, and because of the location. Now they say to this, well, we'll let people choose, and we think they're faced with a dichotomy. Either they let UCT students choose where to go, in which case they're going to end up with a bunch of doctors working in rich Cape Town hospitals anyway, and not anyone out where the people are really suffering in the townships and in rural South Africa, or they force people to go to those places which they should have done as side proposition, and then they're dealing with unhappy people. So we'd say that people are incredibly unhappy and that a year of unhappiness is not something which can be glossed over. Third, there's an opportunity cost. Because for a year of the prime of your life in your 20s, you're not able to find a job, you're not able to pick up career momentum, you're not able to meet someone or have a family, which many people want to do when they're graduating university at 26. Now you can scoff at these harms, but we think they are real. We think they are tangible and we think they're emotive. We don't want to make people suffer for a year of their life. But moreover, we'd say that you undermine people based on the type of job they're doing. Because we'd say that jobs which require experience to get into, such as doctors, already volunteer in places like the US where there isn't this kind of policy. Why? Because you need experience. So you go work for an NGO or Doctors Without Borders, and then you get hired in the private sector. But for jobs which don't need experience, you go straight into the private sector and start earning. That means for those people, you undermine a year in which they're earning massive amounts of money, and they lose all that income. Secondly, what we'd say is that they don't gain any skills, because an actuary can't really teach debating unless they're Luke, in which case we don't think they're gaining any skills anyway, because there's nothing to do with their job description. So what we think is that experience isn't significantly given in those kind of jobs. There is significant harm to the individual. But now let's look at why this policy is illegitimate. And here I would say that these people don't owe society anything, and that therefore what we'd say is that you can't burden them with this. Now let's look at the real analysis besides the shallow legitimacy analysis given to us by their first speaker. Firstly, we'd say that you've got two types of people, either richer people who are paying tax or poorer people who are being subsidized. Now what we'd say is that rich people, A, their parents have paid tax for them. Now what do we mean? It means on all the products you buy your child, on private schooling you pay value-added tax. So they've directly paid tax for their child. But secondly, they will pay tax in their future. Because yes, they've gained from your schools. Yes, they've gained from your roads. And that's why when they've got the ability to earn, when they start working, they will pay you tax. That is why we don't owe the government for services, because that's why it works right now and in every other country in the world. Secondly, if you're a poorer person in society, the government doesn't owe you anything. Or rather, the government owes you things and you don't owe the government anything. Because your position and your start out in life means that you aren't wealthy and that you deserve to be subsidized by your university. That's who's subsidized in universities. That's who's given bursaries. The people from a poor background because of apartheid who can't afford to go to those universities. Why do those people owe us anything, side proposition? Secondly, what we'd say is that this isn't legitimate because it's the government mandate to help people. Now, what do we mean by this? We mean that if there's poverty, if there's poverty and suffering, and if the government is failing to do their job, A, that's because they're failing. They already tax people enough to be able to fix education. We've got plenty of money, but it's their inefficiency which means that we can't. That means they can't add an extra cost onto their citizens. But secondly, if they are to add an extra cost, they must do it right. Because what we'd say is that money is money, but your life is your own. If government needs to fix things, they shouldn't inconvenience people and harm them like I analyzed. They should take some money, maybe a little bit more money, and they need to explain why that isn't a legitimate alternative if they have any hope of showing why they're winning this debate. But now let's look at why even if they owed us something, we still wouldn't tax them. A, because we don't have any form of tax when we can't have something uniform or at least fair. What we'd say is that people in this case work at university or study at university for different amounts of time, contribute differently to society for a year of their life, and lose a different amount of income. That means that they are doing a bunch of different things for people who earn different amounts, and we don't just tax people randomly. We don't think their system can be made fair, and we think that that is another reason it's illegitimate. Lastly, we tell you that education is a necessity, that higher education and tertiary education is becoming necessary for a quality of life. Now, what do we mean? We don't mean it's a basic essential, but we mean to have any good quality of life in a country like the USA, because they didn't define this just as for Africa, we would say that you actually need a tertiary education. What that means is that you're forcing people to be taxed on something which they have to get to live a good life. We'd say much like you don't tax people on things like bread, because it's a basic service, you should no longer tax people on tertiary education, let's be progressive about things. But now let me show you why, even if we assume there was some kind of legitimate obligation, I've got one POI this whole speech, we don't actually aid society. So now what we'd say is that they gave us pretty shallow analysis here. Firstly, because utility doesn't just justify something, right? We would fix poverty if we taxed rich people 90%, but we don't, because just proving it works doesn't mean anything. But secondly, let's look at why it doesn't work. Because yeah, literally, the extent of their analysis was, skilled people do things. Let's look at why skilled people doing things isn't something which really works yet.
So would you say that community service has no tangible benefit to society at all?
No, let me tell you why it doesn't fix society. Because firstly, what's the real problem? We'd say it isn't a lack of people or a lack of doctors in South Africa. It's the fact that our structures are set up so badly. The fact that in government hospitals, there aren't supplies and there aren't enough beds. That means no matter how many doctors you've got, you can't care for people. Or you've got badly structured services. So what does this mean? It means we've got the engineers to build roads, but because we're spending 10 times what any other country spends on building those roads, we're doing it so inefficiently that we can't build enough roads. That means that just putting more people in there doesn't do anything. But secondly, those people don't help you. A, because they're inexperienced. An engineer who just graduated from university isn't the person who should be designing the bridge and designing the road. But secondly, what we'd say is that they're unmotivated and inexperienced. Because what we'd say is that companies like Google recognize that employee happiness is crucial for good performance. If you force people into a job, force them to lose a year of income, and don't pay them, are those inexperienced engineers going to design you a good road? Answer that question. But thirdly, we'd say there's a decreasing marginal utility. Here's where we're going to get a bit fancy. We'd say that for every person you add to the economy, for every person that you have to now control and direct, you lose the ability to efficiently move where those people go to. We'd say that the bigger the pool of workers, the less efficient our already inefficient governments are at directing that pool of labor. Which means that even if they were helping, they're helping less efficiently than they would if we utilize them as contracts from private companies. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a simple truth in today's debate. They haven't done enough to show you why people who pay tax or are owed something by society deserve to be further burdened. But secondly, besides just saying people have skills, they haven't shown you why they really help. I am proud to oppose.